and welcome to Jazz for Curious Readers, just one of the many programs offered by the National Jazz Museum in Harlem. And our guest is the eminent historian, NEA jazz master, eternal jazz advocate, Dan Morgenstern. And Dan's name should be no stranger to anyone who has anything to do with jazz, because as an editor of major magazines, as the director of the Institute of Jazz Studies at Rutgers University for decades, a position he held until not that long ago, and just as a proponent for the music and friend of so many musicians, Dan Morgenstern is someone who's been omnipresent in the jazz world since the late 1940s. Dan continues to be a great source of information for us at the museum, and we are presenting here a lengthy interview that we did with Dan back in 2015 that was particularly memorable. We also hosted a whole day's worth of programming in tribute to Dan that, of course, he attended. This particular interview was a particular favorite of a lot of Dan's close friends, and so we offer it as part of this particular series of online broadcasts. It's audio only. You will see wonderful images of Dan taken over the years, mostly in the more recent years, but there's a couple of real great shots of him with his friend, and I mean his actual friend, not just someone that he knew, Louis Armstrong. And so let's go back to 2015 and this wonderful session with Dan Morgenstern.
Please join me in welcoming a true icon, Dan Morgenstern.
Thank you, Lauren. I think that introduction leaves me speechless. It's far too kind, but I have been around for a while. And I think what you want me to do tonight is to talk about Harlem. And in order to kind of set that up, I will have to briefly fill in a few autobiographical notes and explain that I came to the United States of America in April 21st, 1947, and I was 17 years old, which makes me pretty old right now, as if you can calculate quickly, I was already very interested in jazz. I even had a little, in those days there were only 78s, if any, but some of you are too young to even know what that was, much less, you know, but how much they weighed and how breakable they were. But I had a few of them. I didn't take my entire small collection that I had amassed by then, but I took some of my favorites with me. Anyhow, to make a long story short, it took a little while for me to get my bearings, but not that long. And I had certainly heard about 52nd Street, which at the time, you know, was still Swing Street, although it was no longer what it once had been. And I made my way there, and eventually I, you know, started meeting, talking to musicians. They were all very nice, and I befriended a few. And I also started to hang out at a record store that was very special. It was called the Jazz Record Center, and it was up a flight of stairs on 46th, right off 6th Avenue, and it said on the stairs, it said, walk up, save a buck, everything from bunk to monk. So some of you who might not know what the bunk reference was, that was to Bunk Johnson. So it was taken from one extreme to the other. Anyway, it was run by a very strange and very nice man who at that by then hardly ever moved out of a big, kind of broken down armchair in which he sat and presided over this store, which specialized in secondhand and used collector's item 78s. His name was Joe Klauberg, and he was a full-blooded Pima Indian from Arizona, who in his younger days had been, among other things, a boxer and a barrel house piano player. There was a way broken down piano at the record store. There was also a little kitchen. He lived there. He had spent his whole life there. And Joe was, you know, he was a special case, but some other time I'll talk about him. He told me that Coleman Hawkins and Jimmy Harrison used to come to his, he had an apartment in Harlem, and this is in the 20s, and have jam sessions. And he said, I didn't play the piano too well, but I had a good beat in it. Yeah. Anyway, at this store was a hangout for musicians of the older school, although occasionally a young bebopper might show up. And that's where I met the gentleman seen in this photograph. His name was Nat Lorber, and he was known among musicians as Face. Everybody called him Face. And it was Zudy Singleton, the great drummer, who called, Zudy called everybody something Face. If Zudy noticed that you had a nice tie on, he would say, hello, tie Face. And if you were eating a chicken leg, he would say chicken face, you know, whatever. But Face was just Face, nothing else. But, and you can tell why. Nat was the eldest of three siblings, born to Russian Jewish immigrants. His father was a garment cutter. He was born in Harlem, actually, in 1920. They moved to the Bronx, where he lived in a housing project that, among other things, also contained a young trumpet player whose name was Milton Roginski, but you would better know him as Shorty Rogers. Anyway, Nat told me that Shorty used to practice trumpet in the morning and he used to play Sleepy Time down south. Louis Armstrong was Nat's idol. He had, as a young person, as a child, he suffered from pleurisy, and it caused him to be slightly stunted in his growth. He never learned to read music. He did take some lessons with Charlie Colin, who was a pretty well-known trumpet teacher, and he loved Louis Armstrong, and he was also really hip about other things, and it was through Nat that I got to meet Hot Lips Page. Orrin Hot Lips Page was a sensational trumpet player and singer who never achieved the fame that he deserved, but he was quite well known. He made a lot of records, and he lived in Harlem, and he knew Harlem like the back of his hand. Now, I was not yet really, you know, I mean, I had begun to find my way around New York and all that. And I also had, you know, the old French saying, cherchez la femme. I had met a young lady who was pretty hip, and she was really the first to take me to Harlem. And she had an ulterior motive in that, because she had met a musician who went by the name of Doug Duke. He was a pianist and organ player. He had actually been with Lionel Hampton. If you look in the discography, you will find him with one recording that also had Wes Montgomery on it. But that wasn't his real name. His real name was something Spanish. He was born in Buenos Aires, Argentine. Ovido something. I can't read my own writing. Anyway, he was a very hip organ player, and there was a place in Harlem called the Lenox Lounge. It still exists under that name, but it's not in the same place. And this young lady took me there mainly because I think she didn't want to be alone with Mr. Doug Duke. I was kind of what you might call, they used to call him a beard, whatever. Anyway, it was very exciting. He had a very beautiful organ, and he played it very well. Lauren will know of him because many years later, interesting CD came out. He had by then settled in a place near Rochester, New York, and where he ran a little club called the Music Room, and he invited a host of great people like Coleman Hawkins, Roy Eldridge, Charlie Shavers, you name it. And some of that stuff was recorded, and after he passed away, it came out on a very limited edition. Anyway, that was my first visit to Harlem, but very soon after that, the same young lady took me to the Apollo for the first time. You know, the Apollo is still there, but the Apollo at that time was an entirely different place from what it is now. It had a kind of unique feel to it. What was unique about it was the relationship between the performers and the audience. It was remarkable. The first thing I saw there, which took me to see, and I'll forever be indebted to her for that, was Dizzy Gillespie's big band with Chano Pozo. How many of you know what Chano Pozo means? Okay, good. Okay, fine. He was undoubtedly the greatest Latin percussionist ever, and unfortunately was very short-lived. I was lucky that I got to see him. This would have been in late 1947, and he was killed in an argument, silly argument with somebody, just a few months after that. Anyway, it was a fabulous thing because, first of all, the band was unbelievable at that time. And he was already featured early in the show on a thing called Manteca, which was recorded. It was one of the Gillespie band's biggest hit records, which was a hit in, as it wasn't. Wasn't an Elvis Presley type of hit, but it was a hit. And then he disappeared for a while, and then he came out again, and the lights went down, and he came out. He came out stripped to the waist, bare waist, and carrying a drum and an oil lamp. And against rules, you can't do that on a stage, but they got away with it. He lit the lamp and started heating up his drum. And in the meantime, he started chanting to himself, and the band, the musicians, picked up the chant. And what this turned out to be was a piece which was recorded in Dan, two parts.
Just a little closer to the mic.
It was called Cubano B, Cubano Bob. It's a great arrangement by George Russell, and he was fabulous. And he started to play, he started to chant. The band picked up the chant, and the lights were down, and then they started coming up, and it was a fabulous thing. So that was my introduction to the Apollo. But the Apollo, to give you an example of later on, I saw B.B. King there. B.B., you know, B.B., when he did a slow blues, he would hit a note on the guitar, and then there was a long pause. He would let it linger. He would let it decay for a long time. When he was doing that at the Apollo, somebody with perfect timing yelled out, "Take your time, this is my day off." It's all pandemonium. And I saw the Ellington band there several times, and always the big moment came when Duke would say, "And now, Johnny Hodges." And Johnny would step up with that, you know, expressionless face and would step up to the mic with his alto. And the moment he played the first note, all the women in the audience let out a big sigh. It was really audible, I'm not exaggerating. When you could hear this, So that was the Apollo. One more thing about the Apollo. My friends and I used to go there a lot, and we used to come early because we wanted to get good seats. You know, the theater was a big theater, and when we came to this particular time, we wanted to see Red Fox. How many of you know Red Fox? You know, this was before he was on, on TV, and before he became respectable. He was very disrespectable. I worked briefly at a record store known as The Colony in the Times Square area, and we had Red Fox records under the counter. So he was terrific. But, you know, we asked why the first two rows were roped off. So we sat down in the third row, but we asked, why is it roped off? You know, Dinah Washington and the party are coming to see the show. So Dinah, Dinah was marvelous. She was, oh man. Anyway, she came with a big party, sat down in the front row. And when Red came out, of course he knew she was there. And it was immediately evident that they were friends. And his whole thing, it came to be like a back and forth between them. And the jokes, the lines and everything was unbelievable. And it took me 3 days to recover from that because my gut was sore from laughing so hard. So that was the Apollo. And what happened to me, when I started going to Harlem with Nat Lorber. Nat had been befriended by Hot Lips Page, who was from Texas, and nicknamed Nat. But Lips wasn't very tall, but Nat was shorter. So Lips' nickname for Nat was Shorty, which in his Texas thing came out Shouty. And so that's what he called him. And Lips knew, as I said before, he knew everything about Harlem. And there was an after-hours scene, after legitimate legal hours for bars to be open and for liquor to be sold, there were after-hours places. And they ranged from somebody's not very fancy apartment where there would be an upright piano and a refrigerator full of beer and ice cubes, and there'd be some whiskey and stuff, they're selling booze. And there would be musicians would come and sit in. Lips loved sitting in. Even when he had a gig and had been playing all night, he still wanted to play some more, sing some more. And so if you were hanging out with him, you would always wind up in some after-hours place. Now that was, one was like I said, just a very simple apartment with nothing fancy. And, but on the block where Minton's was, Minton's has reopened. Minton's was this legendary club where supposedly bebop was born, which is a bunch of nonsense. It wasn't, but it was important to the music. And by the time I started coming to Harlem, the Mittens was still going, but it was just like another nightclub. There was a nice band. Jerome Richardson was a good tenor player. I had a band there first time I ever went there, but it wasn't anything, you know. It had this legendary reputation, but it wasn't really anything special. But right down the street was the Braddock, which was a hotel. In that hotel, I don't think it was officially connected with the hotel, but there was a kind of speakeasy type of entrance down in the basement off the street, where you really, you know, had to know a password. But when you entered, it was a fully appointed, really first-class nightclub with a bandstand, with food and drinks and everything. And you wouldn't even know after a while that you were out after hours. It was just like that. So that was one. The third kind of place was the most special one that I experienced with Lips. It was arranged like a social club. You walked in and there was a lobby and there were people sitting at a desk. And if you were a member, you had a membership card. If you were not, they signed you up and it paid some, you know, very low amount and you became a member. And then you were admitted downstairs. And there, I've written about this, so it may be redundant to some of you, but the night that I came there with Lips and Nat, it couldn't have been like that every night, but it was like something out of a dream. It was a nicely appointed room, you know, and there was a piano. The piano was on rollers, so it was an upright. And the way it was that particular night, it was kind of in the middle of the floor. And at the piano was none other than Art Tatum. And Art Tatum had at his feet, sitting at his feet, Charlie Shavers, great trumpet player, who also was, by the way, a terrific pianist. He was a great arranger. And he was also a hell of a piano player, although he never recorded on it, but I heard him play it. It's great. And Joe Bushkin, who was a well-known pianist, lived a long life and was quite well-known, had been with Tommy Dorsey and other bands. They were sitting on the floor at Art's feet, and I think Art turned to Charlie Shavers and said, "Any note you play, I'll play figure eights around it." And at a table nearby, sitting by herself, the specialty there, like in many places in Harlem, was chicken in the basket. And the eating chicken in the basket was Billie Holiday. So, you know, I mean, that was quite an evening. Art eventually, he had been playing and he started playing again. And here he played solo, you know, just in that environment. It wasn't a great piano, it was an upright, but it was in tune. And anyway, many years later, quite a few years later, after I'd been in the Army and I went to Brandeis on the GI Bill, we started a relationship with George Wein, who had the club Story Roll in Boston. This is just before the first Newport Jazz Festival. And we asked George if we could bring musicians that were playing at the club, if we could bring them to the school. And he said, yes, you could do that on a Saturday afternoon if you arrange it with them. And you can't do it on Sunday because we have a Sunday afternoon jam session. So anyway, when Art Tatum was there. Art was by then for many years already working with the trio, but we wanted him by himself. And so we asked him if he would come and do an afternoon solo concert, and he said yes immediately. And so we got the best piano in the place, and there was a nice hall that was suitable for that kind of thing. And it was a marvelous, marvelous afternoon. And then we drove Art back to, Brandeis is in Waltham, it's about 16 miles out of Boston. Drove him back to Boston, and I was sitting in the back with him, and I thanked him. It was a wonderful concert. And he said, you know, I'm the one who should thank you, because this is the first time I've ever done a concert all by myself. Mm. And I was totally flabbergasted. This is in 1955. Art only lived to 1956. He died much too young. He had done concerts, yes, but always with something else on the program. So this is he was happy that he had done a solo concert all by himself. It took a while before I became professionally involved in jazz after that, but I think in retrospect, that was one of the things that made me think that maybe something could be done to change that kind of situation where a genius like Art Tatum had never been presented in a proper solo concert.
Dan, I have a question for you.
Yeah.
To go back to the Apollo Theater just for a moment, could you describe, I mean, it's, from what I understand from the way you've talked about it, it was such a different experience for people who had never been to that kind of theater in an African American community, the way that the audience responded to the artists, it was just like such a different thing that if you haven't been in that particular thing in those days, even also added to it, it's an experience I think most of us probably can't really understand. Could you sketch that a bit for us?
Well, the Apollo, of course, was not confined to jazz. In fact, there were a lot of people who came to the Apollo who didn't primarily come to hear the jazz act. There were comedians. There was a chorus line quite frequently. There was a movie. It was like one of the first run Broadway theaters at the time that always had a stage show. Anyway, the relationship, as I tried to say before, between the audience and the performers was very, very special. And you'd have people like Moms Mabley, who was a wonderful female comedian. They were rare. And somebody like, there was a well-known guy then named Pig Meat Markham. Pig Meat, that's a you wouldn't probably get that today. The comedy could be pretty well. I mentioned Red Fox. I mean, it was not suitable for children, although children were sometimes there. The Apollo also, and I went to that a few times. They had gospel shows also, and the gospel things were fabulous and give you a sense of what might happen there. In the aisles, in every aisle, there were two or three nurses to take care of anybody who was perhaps seized by the spirit and went into some kind of conniption fit. I never witnessed that, but they were there. Those ladies were there in uniform. That of course was audience participation all the way, and so it was a special place. I mean, there was a Earl Hines big band recorded a piece called Second Balcony Jump, The second balcony at the Apollo was the cheapest seats, and that could get pretty rocky, though. the band was hot and it would, the balcony would kind of move a little bit. And supposedly somebody once jumped out of there. So I'll go to the Apollo one more time. They had a memorable thing there where they featured several drummers. And one of them was Buddy Rich, who happened to break an arm while during the engagement. And he insisted on playing with just one arm and actually outplayed Philly Joe Jones and Art Blakey. I'm not kidding, you know, they had a drum thing at the end, and Buddy was something else. The Apollo was right. If you were a white performer, and if you were good, they were perfectly open to you. You know, they were very hospitable. If you could do your thing, that was fine.
Could you talk about Puerto Rico and what happened to people who couldn't?
Puerto Rico was the guy. They had amateur night at the Apollo. I went to amateur night maybe once, because most of it was pretty horrible. No, it was amateur night, and they came out and tried to do something, you know, sing or dance or whatever, you know, or do stand-up. And they had this guy whose nickname was Puerto Rico, and he had the hook. And, you know, if the audience was the judge, and if they started to boo, he'd come out with them, and he'd pull them off with the hook, you know, and that was it. But, of course, at the Apollo, legendary, Ella Fitzgerald's winning amateur night was not at the Apollo. That was at the Lincoln Theater, which was a predecessor. And for a while, they were both active there. But Sarah Vaughan won the amateur thing at the Apollo, and that's how she got her first job with Earl Hines. Anyway, I mean, there were other things there. As far as Harlem was concerned, there was, at the time, you know, the community was, it was a different era, and there were really great places to eat. There was a chain called Sherman's Barbecue, and they had great barbecue, but the best thing was the potato salad. I had never since had better potato salad than the potato salad there. It was legendary. Any of you are Louis Jordan fans? Do you know who Louis Jordan was? Yes. So Louis Jordan had one of my favorites, actually, this thing called Early in the Morning, where he sings about, you know, I've been out all night and it's early in the morning, and he hasn't got anything but the blues. And he sings this one lyric is, I went to Jenny Lou's to get something to eat, and the waitress looked at me and said, Pops, you sure look beat. And that's early in the morning, and I ain't got nothing but the blues. Jenny Lou's was the place that was famous for breakfast, and it was such a lovely place. It was down a flight of stairs, and it was the prettiest inside. I mean, it wasn't very big, and it wasn't really fancy, but it was super neat, and it was kind of Southern style, and everything, they had these nice little doilies on the tables, and everything was so nice, and there were, you know, little flower on the in a vase on each table, and they had the best, man, that the breakfasts were out of sight. You know, it wasn't anything fancy, just, you know, eggs and hash browns. Oh man, great. No, that was, and coffee. Then there were nice bars like Sugar Ray Robinson had a place called Sugar Ray's, which didn't have music, but it was very sociable. And there weren't that many, even then in the late 40s, there were not that many clubs in Harlem that featured jazz. The after-hours places that I mentioned, you know, that was one thing. But there was a place next to the Apollo called the Baby Grand. They had music there, but it wasn't particularly great. There was Smalls, which lasted a long time. And Smalls used to have really good stuff. And that was a bigger place. And there was a place called Wells, which was a little off to the west side, and that was another place that was famous for Chicken in the Basket, and they mainly featured organs. Organs were popular in Harlem, and that was even before Jimmy Smith. The Wells had good organ players. And one interesting fact is that a very young Dick Hyman had a steady job for a while at Wells, playing organ and piano.
I have a question. Another question, Dan. In all the interviews that we've done here over the years with people from those days, and in fact, the owner of the Lennox Lounge and different places, when we talked about the nightclubs, invariably, none of them, if I asked for their favorite nightclub, no one said Minton's, no one said the famous clubs. They all said Small's Paradise to a man. And I'm always wondering, do you have any idea what it was about Small's that was special or unique, like why it would have been a favorite place?
First of all, Small's was bigger than those places. It's bigger than Minton's or Atlantis Lounge.
It wasn't that small.
It wasn't small. The man who owned it was Small. That was his name. That it was named for him. It had several levels, and it would have shows as well as music. I know that they had tap. That was the thing that I hadn't mentioned before. Tap dancers were very popular, and there was a wonderful tap dancer named Teddy Hale, who was he was in the dressing room changing, and somebody had an argument next door, and it shot killed him. It wasn't even aimed at him. It was
through the wall. Oh Jesus!
Right there, he was tremendous, Teddy Hale. Smalls was, it had a happy atmosphere.
How did people dress going to a place like that? I mean, was the typical dress that you would go in with a tie and you would dress up to go to a place?
In Harlem, especially on Sundays, everybody would be dressed because Sunday was also going to church day. And everybody was pretty much dressed up. And Saturday night, too. People dressed nicely. They did, you know. And Smalls was a very cheerful guy, and he ran the club. And I think everybody who worked there was treated well. So the help, you know, the waiters and the waitresses, you know, that they were very friendly, and the service was good. And had a nice atmosphere. I'll give you a quick one thing that I always remember about Smalls. It was much later, I was at the Cookery in the Village. That was a place that was run by Barney Josephson, who was the famous guy who had Cafe Society downtown and then retired for a while and then started another place in the Village. They had great stuff. Joe Turner was there for a while, and Alberta Hunter, and so on. And one night I was there, and John Hammond was there. And John, you know who John Hammond was, the legendary talent spotter with everybody from Billie Holiday to Bruce Springsteen. And we were not close, but we were friendly, so he... After the set break, I think we went to see Mary Lou Williams, who played there quite often, who was wonderful. He said, come on, he said, I want you to hear somebody. So it was summertime, and John had a convertible. It parked there outside. So where were we going? We were going to Harlem. We were going to Smalls. And here's the thing. This was, you know, by then it was after the first set of the cookery. So it would have been around 11 o'clock, 10:30. You know. The moment John pulled up in front of Smalls, there were a few guys standing in front. Two of them came over immediately.
A little closer to the mic. I'm sorry.
They came over and said, "Good evening, John." Said, you know, he gave them the keys, and they would, you know, there was, you could, it's always hard to park, you know, in the middle of there. They took care of the car. I went in with him, and the moment he stepped into the place, there was Smalls, and he was greeted like royalty. And the place was packed. It was packed, but they found place for us up on the there was a balcony level. And who was there that he wanted me to hear? It was George Benson, who was practically unknown at the time. Although I knew about it because he'd been with Jack McDuff, so I'd seen him. But that was John, you know. I mean, even at that late date, this is, what is it?
The early 60s, probably.
Yeah, and a little later, yeah, mid-60s, maybe, yeah. He was still, you know, he was still in Harlem. He could have been, you know, FDR, whatever. I didn't talk yet about jam sessions. And that, of course, was an aspect of Hot Lips Page was, he was the king of jam sessions. He thrived on that, and he could outplay anybody. But he wasn't out to do that. He was just out to have a good time. But he could just ignite the place. And he also was an unbelievably great blues singer. I liked him better than Joe Turner, who could only sing in one key. Everything Joe Turner did was C. Anyway, I remember Roy Eldridge telling me he and Milt Jackson were on a record date with Joe Turner. And after the first three numbers, they turned to each other and said, "Everything's ever going to change the key?" But everything was in the
I can
same
testify
key.
That I actually played piano for Joe Turner one night at the West End, and it's true. Everything was in C. I just experienced that myself, actually. Dan, I have another question for you. Were there musicians who lived in Harlem, who played in Harlem, who weren't really that well known, or who weren't known downtown, or didn't make records or something like that, but who were legends in the clubs and stuff?
They were not necessarily legends, but there were a lot of musicians who lived in Harlem. And at that point in time, many musicians of the older generation, I mean, they were certainly not ancient, but they had established themselves during the swing era, and a lot of them were not finding that much work anymore. So you could, for instance, there was a fashion show at Smalls. That was on a Sunday afternoon, and the band was, it was a quintet, and the leader was a legendary tenor saxophonist named Happy Caldwell. Happy Caldwell was actually slightly older than Coleman Hawkins, and, you know, had recorded back in 1923, and been on a lot of legendary record dates, and he had a beautiful big sound, amazing. And there was, in the band was a trumpet player whom I had never heard of named Archie Johnson, and I later found out that he'd been with Lucky Millinder, and he actually has a couple of solos on Millinder records. But he was tremendous. I mean, he was just a wonderful player, and I was amazed at and I started talking to him, and said, you know, I mean, he had gigs in uptown, but not much else. And so, yes, and Mansi Johnson, who was a drummer had been with Don Redman and all kinds. So there were a whole lot of musicians. That reminds me of, you know, this was, 47 was still pretty early in the bebop era, which really didn't last that long. The real bebop era is really a 45 to 50 about, that's about it. Not that the music didn't continue after, but that was sort of the, that was really the bebop era. Actually, Nat, well, he's gone from there, but Nat Lorber also introduced me to a terrific lady, girl, she wasn't that old, the lady, she was a lady, who at the time was handling Louis Armstrong's fan mail. Louis would get mail almost every day, and, you know, there would be something. She once showed me an envelope that said Satchmo USA. It was delivered. Okay. No. And this is before Hello Dolly. I mean, you know, we way back then. But it was true. Her name was Jean Fellows, and it was through her that I got to meet Louis, and that, of course, was a big event in my life. But Jean was also into bebop, and she was working at the time, she was working for Music Craft Records, and she had met a young man named Nard Griffin, who she helped him get a little pamphlet published that was called To Be or Yes. Not to Bop. And it's actually the first, have you seen it?
Yes, yeah. It was, we have a copy.
Yeah, we have a copy at the Institute, too. And I met him. He was a really nice guy, a young man, and he had taken there some interesting
photos
there that you don't see anywhere else. So she was into, you know, she loved Louis, and she was into Louis, but she was also hospitable to bebop. And she, for a while, she ran some sessions at a place called the Club Harlem, on 145th Street. Right near the park there, you know, there's
sure.
a park. And I remember once that she would have mainstream band, and that night there was a band with Joe Thomas, great trumpet player, and Sandy Williams, who had been featured trombonist with Chick Webb. Then she had a bunch of young beboppers. And I remember standing with Joe and Sandy listening to that, and that was new to me too, pretty much at the time, although I had, you know, I've heard Dizzy, and I'd seen Charlie Parker with Miles at the Three Deuces on 52nd Street. But so you've got, and it was interesting because I remember distinctly that you know, that Joe and Sandy were trying, you know, to listen to these guys. And then Sandy turned to Joe and he said, they're not telling a story. Now, telling a story was an expression among older musicians, but I think it still is. It's still being used today. Is it?
Should be.
I would use it. But it means not saying anything that tells, that has an emotional impact, emotional meaning. And so that that also happened on that particular night. Nat Lorber and somebody I had met through him, who was quite a character too, a guy named Steve Trupp, who, like me, had been born in Europe and actually was born in Vienna, and whose parents had come to the U.S. a little before the war broke out, in 1939, actually. His father was a Reichian analyst. I don't know whether that means anything to any of you.
Yes.
Wilhelm Reich was a... originally a follower of Sigmund Freud, and actually Freud thought very highly of him, but then he got off on his own kick and invented something called the orgone box, which he was supposed to sit in, and it had rays, and he went a little over the top. Eventually got himself in trouble eventually with the government, which was sad. But anyhow, Steve was an aspiring poet and actually became a very good poet. There is an obscure record on Folkways that has him and some other poets reading. But at the time, he was an aspiring drummer. Didn't have much technique, but he had very good time. He was very good on brushes. And he actually went out on the road with a band that was led by Pinky Williams, who was a good baritone player. Pinky was one of those people, like you mentioned, he lived in Harlem and nobody really knew about
him. Was Pinky related to Skippy?
He's Skippy's brother.
Okay.
Yeah. Skippy was a tenor player who he took Ben Webster's place with Duke Ellington.
And Herschel Evans' place with Basie.
All right, He was good, Skippy.
I have a question for you. There was a lot made, during the Harlem Renaissance days of the interchange with writers and you already mentioned poets and stuff like that. And during the period that you were in Harlem, James Baldwin and then later on other people like Malcolm X and Adam Clayton Powell and Billy Taylor even. Different kinds of people who were involved in the wider ranges of things. Did you encounter...
Those are all very, in many ways.
That's why I mentioned it.
I never did get to meet Malcolm X, but let me tell you one thing about Malcolm X, which I think may astonish some people here. My good friend and colleague for many years, Ed Berger, who's at the Institute of Jazz Studies, who recently published a biography of Joe Wilder, which I would recommend highly to everybody. It's a wonderful book, and it was a wonderful life that Joe had. He died at the age of 90, I think, last year. But Ed's father, who was a well-known sociologist, he was a professor at Princeton, who also did some work for the State Department and for a while lived in Egypt with his family. And Malcolm X was passing through Cairo on his way to the Hajj. He was doing this thing, Malcolm X was a big jazz fan. That I knew before Ed told me this, that he was a jazz fan. But what I didn't know was that, what he asked at the American consulate in Cairo if anybody had any good jazz record collection, because he was spending a few days there and he wanted to hear some music. So they told him about Mauro Berger, who had a nice collection of jazz records. And so Malcolm went to visit, and the first thing he asked to hear was Louis. Turned out that he was a big Louis Armstrong fan, which is not something that is mentioned in the literature. Another big Armstrong fan, of course, was Ralph Ellison, whom I did get to meet once, and who used Louis. Have you all read Invisible Man? You should. If you haven't, you definitely should.
We had an exhibit here about Ralph Ellison, actually. Yeah.
About his record collection, But Jimmy Baldwin, I met not in Harlem, where he wasn't hanging out at the time, but in the village, in Greenwich Village. I met him around that same time.
What are some of your favorite things written about Harlem culture and about life in Harlem and about stuff? I mean, if you were... All those years at the Institute, you directed millions of people to all these wonderful books and things. I'm curious, if somebody wanted to read about Harlem, written by Harlemites or things, what would you... What's good?
There are a number of novels spread over many decades that have action take place in Harlem, but most of them are not about what we're talking about, you know, the there are books, nonfiction books about Harlem. I can't think of one that I would, that I'm particularly crazy about. So you have to piece it together more or less. You know what? Actually, the very brief thing on Harlem that is very hip is something that you wouldn't expect at all. There was a magazine called Vanity Fair, and maybe it still exists. Anyway, in 1930, they put out a guide to New York nightlife. It's a hardcover. It's quite pretty. The Institute has two copies of it. And in my early days at the Institute, I saw this thing and I looked at it, and it has a section on Harlem. It has a section on Harlem, and it gives some sage advice. It's of course, it's aimed at white people, and it says, if you're going to Harlem, the best thing is to bring a girl with you, and it helps if she's a pretty girl.
We need the mic, Dan, I'm sorry.
And so that is very good advice, because then the reason for that is that then you know if you're, you know, if that people will know that you're not there looking for female company. So it also lists a bunch of places, some of which we know and some of which existed then and we don't know much about. It talks about the music and it talks about the food.
Okay.
And it's very hip. It gives very nice advice.
You know, I'm just trying to jump in there.
No,
sorry,
but you mentioned Adam Clayton Powell. Yeah. He was, of course, married to Hazel Scott, right?
Yes.
And so Hazel Scott was a pianist and singer who was very popular for a while.
One of the things about these evenings that we do here is at the end, we do a question and answer period. But I assume we have a whole bunch of students here who are busily transcribing and making notes and all this kind of stuff. And so I'd just like to say that we would like to open up the floor, because one of the things about what we do at the museum is that sometimes it's the interchanges where the real magic happens. So it's funny, you mentioned we were talking about Small's Paradise. We had Clark Terry here years ago, and he was at an air base called Small's Air Base in the Midwest somewhere. And somebody said, no, and it turns out he was related that the Smalls of Smalls Air Base was a famous African-American general or Navy person, and he was related to Ed Smalls, who actually was the Smalls of Smalls Paradise. And Clark never knew that until somebody mentioned it. It's kind of interesting. Any questions from the audience? Maybe some of the young people, too, would like to ask a question. That would be really nice. Well, you're not young, but go ahead.
apropos of your question, Lauren, about books about Harlem, have either of you read Timmy Rosenkrantz's memoirs, which were reissued a couple of years ago?
Oh, yeah. Well, Timmy Rosenkrantz was a Danish baron, and I spent quite a bit of my early life in Denmark, so, and I knew Timmy. And Timmy lived in Harlem for a while. He was a huge jazz fan, and also tried to do some promotion and stuff, and he was on the radio, and was a real character. So that book has some interesting things in it about Harlem. It's all anecdotal, right? You know, but he tried to run a record store. Bye, Peter.
Hi, Dan. Thank you.
Thank you for coming.
Timmy Rosenkrantz tried to run a record store in Harlem?
Timmy opened a record store in Harlem, and it was not a financial success. Nothing Timmy did was a financial success. He was always broke, but he tried. But something, I forget what it is about, I think he needed copies of Bunny Berrigan's I Can't Get Started. I think that was something that there's a 12-inch record,
right,
and they broke, and you know, all that stuff. Anyway, Timmy was, but there are some nice things about Harlem in there. He met a young woman named Inez Kavanaugh, who actually was an aspiring journalist, and she came to interview him, and they became lovers and eventually had a very long-lasting relationship. And Inez was the vocalist in Don Redman's band that came to Europe in 1946, which was the first American band to come to Denmark after the war, and it was a sensation. I went to 2 concerts, standing room only, and it was tremendous.
And Billy Taylor was the pianist.
Taylor was the pianist, and Billy and I used to kid, but Billy was 25, I was 16. I mean, so and they had one thing in the book. It was mostly standard stuff, and Don Byas was the star. He was a marvelous tenor player. And but they had one arrangement in the book which was bebop tinged, and it was by Tad Dameron, who was a fine arranger, composer, and a pianist. It was okay, but a little limited. But they had a piece called "For Europeans Only" that he had written especially for the concert. And when I came to New York, one of the things, that same young lady who took me to the Apollo also took me to the Royal Roost, which was like a piece of Harlem in the Times Square area. The Royal Roost preceded Birdland, but it was run by the same people. And it was a little bit of Harlem. They had Chicken in the Basket, and the whole atmosphere was about like that. And I was in Times Square. And I went with this young lady and a friend of hers. They're both very pretty girls. And immediately, and on the break, it was Tad Dameron's sextet with Fats Navarro. And I think Charlie Rouse was the tenor player. But anyway, they came over to our table, and I was able to tell Tad that I had heard his piece performed in Copenhagen. And he was so happy about that, and he was so delighted with that, that we became friends. We became friends for, you know, for the rest of his life.
Dan, about Harlem, how did Harlem change? I mean, I know that in the 60s, you went to Chicago to edit Downbeat magazine. And I assume that by the time you came back, I mean, Harlem had already changed tremendously. But I'm wondering if you could talk about how you saw the change that happened in Harlem throughout the 40s to the 50s to the 60s.
Well, it had changed well before then. I'm saying that even in the late 40s, I've mentioned all these places, and there was one I hadn't mentioned, which was a real working class place called the Lotus Club, where Lips also took us, and that was like, it was a real down-home place, and it's the only bar I've ever been to that had a turnstile. It had a turnstile,
like Cats of Delicatessen,
so that you couldn't leave without paying. You know that you couldn't get out if you hadn't paid for your drinks. There was already not a whole lot of jazz in Harlem. It sounds like a lot, but it wasn't really. And there was less and less as time went by. And but one of the last things kind of interesting was at Wells, and that was when Leonard Feather hosted, it's the very fine trumpet player who had come over from England, but he was originally from Dizzy Reese. That was one of the last jazz things I went to in Harlem, aside from, you know, the Apollo continued to have some jazz. And but by the time I got back from Chicago, this is already 71, so there's hardly anything left.
Did you ever go to...
started up again. Now there's actually quite a bit.
Did you ever go to Count Basie's club?
Yeah. I went to Basie's.
What was Basie's several like? Times. And did he actually have anything to do with it, or was it just the name?
Well, he didn't have much to do with it, and one reason why I know that is that there was a town hall concert that Basie was on. It was a pretty weird concert. It was one of those all-star things, and it was at the jam session at the end where they all played 1 o'clock jump, and Coltrane was on it. And anyway, Basie, after the thing, we were talking to Basie backstage, and this was also one thing that happened there was they went overtime, and in places like Town Hall or Carnegie Hall, which is even higher scale, when you go overtime, even if you just go over by a fraction, there is immediately the unions, the stagehands, get overtime and they get paid. Even if it's only 2 minutes, they get paid for an hour, and it's double time, overtime. All right. Anyway, what happened was that they went over with the 1 o'clock jump, and after it was over, stage manager said to Mr. Basie, "I couldn't drop the curtain on you." So they got by. But Basie felt like, like doing something more. So I forget who I was with, but I'm sure that at least one person I was with was probably a pretty girl. In any case, he said, "Let's go uptown, let's go to Basie's. Let's go to my club and everything." So we got a cab and went to Basie's. And when he walked in, it was, it was great because apparently it was clear that he very, very rarely was there. So it was a big event that he came, and of course he sat in and started. Basie was a very warm and really down home person. I didn't get to know him well, but well enough to say that.
We have a question over here from our education director, Ryan.
Hey, Dan. Now when we go to hear jazz, generally it's a pretty consistent experience. You pay a bunch of money, you sit for 90 minutes if you're lucky, and you're out the door, and you clap for solos, and everyone's very polite and quiet. How does that compare to the experiences you would get in Harlem or other clubs around New York City? Was it more loose, or was it a similar type of environment?
Well, I think it was probably a bit looser than it is now. And there wasn't this, which sometimes gets me a little annoyed, is that there is this tendency now to applaud after every, so even if it's only, very short. And then what happens is, if you start applauding for somebody, then you have to applaud for everybody, and it's a drag. Also, the applause, especially in a concert hall, you miss the first few bars of the next solo because of the applause. So, no, there wasn't. It wasn't like that. If you went to a club like Jimmy Ryan's or something, you wouldn't feel forced to applaud after every solo. You let the musicians know that you like what they did, but it wasn't. So it was more relaxed, actually. Also, even though, economy of the day, it wasn't cheap, but it was not as expensive as it is now. And I learned various tricks. Trick was to, if you order. I mean, I would always stay at the bar. Very rarely at tables, only when it's a special occasion or I had a date or something. I'd stay at the bar, and if you ordered a beer, drink it from the bottle. Don't pour it in the glass, because the bottle is opaque, and, you know, you can hold it, and the bartender won't know, you know, how much is left. They don't bother you.
Young people don't listen.
And so that was, and then I learned another one, which was better for the bartender, was to order your first drink and give the bartender a nice tip, and then they would leave you alone. You could stay all night, and they wouldn't bother you.
Dan, I'd like to take it back for a moment to the tap dancers. And when I asked about the Apollo before, and you responded, and you said, well, it wasn't all jazz there and all that kind of stuff. Right. It was just part of the musical culture. You'd hear a jazz band, you'd hear a gospel quartet, you might hear all different kinds of music, and people weren't just going like jazz. It was the popular culture of the time. And when you mentioned the tap dancers, I imagine now if you said to a jazz audience, like if I went to a jazz club and a tap dancer came out, most of the people would say, like, what the hell is this? I came to hear a jazz group. But at that point, I assume it would have been like, no, I mean, it's just rhythm anyway, so what's the big deal? So who were some of the great tap dancers, and were they known by the musicians, and did they respect each other? There was a strong bond
between musicians and tap. Well, at the Apollo, one fairly regular with Atkins and Cole, Annie Coles and his partner, Charlie Atkins. Honey was very tall, and Charlie was shorter, but they were beautiful tap dancers. And then there was Baby Lawrence, who was the greatest jazz tap dancer. He actually tapped things that are like great jazz solos. And he was tremendous, and he could interact. He could do fours and eights with with a horn player or with a drummer. Drummers and tap dancers had a very good relationship. So yes, and there were others. Bunny Briggs, who died not long ago. He was 90 something. Ellington used him in the first sacred concert. David danced to the Lord with all his might, which is Come Sunday up tempo. Bunny was tremendous with Bunny. Before that, he was featured with Charlie Barnett, which was one of a really hip band, and one of the first white bands to really start integrating and have more than just one star performer, but really have a bunch of African-American musicians in the band. He had Bunny, who didn't, none of the Obits mentioned that, but Bunny would sing as well as dance. He did a great thing on East Side, West Side with scatting. And one time, Marshall Stearns, who was the founder of the Institute of Jazz Studies and one of the first serious American jazz scholars, and the guy who had a marvelous record collection, and altogether was quite a guy. He presented an afternoon of tap at Newport when it was still at Newport, which had had four extraordinary tap dancers. And one of them was a guy named Pete Nugent, who was a little older than the others. And Pete was supposedly the guy who taught Fred Astaire how to tap.
Really?
No. But that was wonderful. And it's too bad that it was not, it should have been filmed. It was just, the four of them were, you know, it was like a jam session, and it was like a cutting contest in a way. It's remarkable.
Did you see the Nicholas Brothers?
The Nicholas Brothers, Dan? Did you see the Nicholas
Brothers? The Nicholas Brothers, yeah, they could do more than tap. I mean, they were acrobats, and they were in the movies. You know, they do that, Pardon Me, Boys, that's the Chattanooga Sugar, they do that. They were in several movies. Yeah, they were amazing. They started as kids. I think the earliest short that you see them in, they're not even in their teens yet. So yeah, and they had long career. They could sing too. You know. There was really a strong relationship between jazz and dance, which it's dance music, you know. I mean, it wouldn't have been big bands if it wasn't for them. The big bands didn't exist because people went to concerts to hear them. They played for dancing. That's how they made their living. That's what they did. That's what jazz was all about.
I think
the relationship between jazz and dancing is except for a few people like Albert Murray. The relationship between not professional dancers, but dancers and the music is totally underestimated. I mean, people are like, we didn't mention the Savoy Ballroom, which is the heart of Harlem, music in Harlem, where they had two bands. There were two stands, one on each end of a very long ballroom. And the bands would actually get into rivalries there. And there were dancers, remarkable dancers who would put on a show, you know, on their own, spontaneously, and just ordinary people who were dancing. And that was like a huge thing, you know. And Lester Young talks about that, you know, how the dancers would inspire him, you know, watching the dancers and make him play in response to that. Now we all sit like a bunch of dummies, you know, listening to music, but that's, yeah.
I was going to add something. I was going to say that, you know, all that great Duke Ellington music that everybody knows, all those famous big band pieces, I heard them first played for listening, and then maybe 10 years later I saw them danced to. And you really can't understand Ellington's big band music without seeing people dance to it. So if you just come to it from studying the score or listening to the record or going to a concert, you haven't experienced it in the milieu in which it was created. And it's like 50% of the meaning is there. You know what I mean? It's fascinating. Dan, one last question for you. And this one I'm really curious about. You mentioned you come to the States, you're 17, so you're from another continent and you love jazz, but you come to New York and magically you meet the Pied Piper of Harlem, you meet Hot Lips Page, and you have access to, like, you know, the places and the things. Could you talk about how it felt to be someone from far away, coming to a new country, and being so deep in an African-American community, and how you were welcomed and made to feel not at all like a stranger, but like a... I'd like to talk about that for subsequent generations for whom this will be, if you'll, for all of us, it'll be history, and we need to know how you felt about it.
Well, as they say on television now all the time, that's a good question. They always say that, but it is a good question.
Thank you.
It really requires a long answer because it's
good.
It's complicated.
Tell us about it. I
grew up in Europe during a not very nice time, and I was lucky insofar as my mother and I wound up after Hitler marched into Austria, which is where I started out, that we wound up in Denmark, which turned out to be a country where the people, ordinary people, were just wonderful and on, you know, their own volition and at the risk of their lives, managed to save all the Jews who were in Denmark, except for a few that didn't do the right thing when they were told to do certain things. Well, it got us all to Sweden and all that. So I was very much, you know, I had become interested in things American because it'd be too complicated for me to get into all of that. But my my parents were separated by the events of my father, who was a writer and who had done written anti-Nazi stuff, had to get out of Austria. He actually got out on the last train to Switzerland, last train out. If it had got one train later, he wouldn't have made it. So anyway, he went from there to France. We couldn't get into France, he couldn't get into Denmark, so we were, you know, separated there. But he managed to come to the to America in 1941. So by the time, you know, once we knew, my mother and I knew that he was dead, this is before Pearl Harbor, so there was still possible to communicate. We didn't know where he was for a long time because it would have been too dangerous for him to write to us while he was on the run. But anyway, I knew that I would wind up in America, and I also had this beginning of an interest in jazz, which inevitably led you to become acquainted with African Americans. Armstrong and Ellington. Ellington is the first thing that I fell in love with. So, in jazz, before Louis. So anyway, I was very conscious of all that. And I was also aware of coming that America had a problem, and that the problem was the race problem. There was a Swedish sociologist named Gunnar Myrdal, who written a book called what it's called, American Dilemma.
Can't remember
the name. Yeah, but which was mentioned quite recently. It's been rediscovered, and that I got a hold of that, and I had been reading a lot of stuff. I read Richard Wright, and I was very aware of, in you know, of getting into things American, and I also knew that there was English, which is what we were being taught in Denmark. You start very early, you start in sixth grade. I can hop, I can run, see me hop, see me run. It is fun, fun, fun. First English lesson. Okay, with the drawing of a rabbit. So I went to American movies, and I listened to singers and stuff. And anyway, I read stuff like there was a novel by Erskine Caldwell called Trouble in July. I read Richard Wright. I was very interested in that particular aspect because it also struck a chord with what was happening to us as Jews in Europe at that time. So anyway, when I came to America, I was interested immediately in observing what was going on in the way of race relations. And because of my getting involved in the jazz world fairly quickly, I got to meet, you know, a lot of black people, including the girl who took me to the Apollo had a girlfriend who at that time was sitting unusual. She married an African American. He was a musician, he was not a jazz musician. He wanted to be a serious composer, serious in quotes. Anyway, so I got into that, and I met a lot of people, including, you mentioned, James Baldwin. I met him. There was a place in the village called San Remo. It was a bar where a lot of writers and intellectuals hung out. And my father's a writer, you know, who Jimmy at the time hadn't really published very much as yet. And he was going to Paris. He had got a fellowship, a Rosenfeld fellowship. Anyway, we became kind of friendly for a while there, and then he went away. And he came back years later, and we came to Newport, and we actually listened to Louis together. That was the first time he'd ever seen Louis. And memorably, when Louis played the Star Spangled Banner at the end, Jimmy turned to me and said, "You know, that's the first time I've liked that song." Mm. Louis played that in a very definitive manner. But anyway, that, you know, that it just became something that after a while it was something that I was very conscious of. And there were things like what was happening politically. I probably was not very well advised to. I rang doorbells for Henry Wallace's campaign, Progressive Party. I don't know if any of you know that there was what that was all about. But at that time, one of the people who campaigned for Wallace was Paul Robeson, and there was a rally at Yankee Stadium for Wallace where Robeson spoke, and let me tell you, that man had a voice that, you know, he could have made me do anything at that point. You know, it was tremendous. And then there was an incident at Peekskill where Robeson was supposed to perform, and a bunch of local Nazis, stopped it. Then there was a movement for the next. It was a weekend at Peekskill where that performance was supposed to have taken place. It was decided to put it on the next week, and like a schnook, I went on this thing, and they threw rocks at us and stuff. So that's but In the end, what happened was that the jazz world was really the first. It was the first thing in American life that became publicly integrated. Before baseball, you know, Teddy Wilson and Lionel Hampton were Benny Goodman and Roy Eldridge with Gene Krupa and all of it. But underneath all that, which was probably, and Hot Lips Page with Artie Shaw.
Right.
And then underneath that, there was all that friendships in among musicians, which preceded that and which wasn't as public, but which was something that, that I fortunately became part of. And, you know, that's it.
Well, what the aspect of it that I was interested in, besides all those fascinating things, and I have to mention that we were, as part of this Harlem Speak series, we had Paul Robeson Jr. So it's wonderful that your interview now will be, we can cross-reference it with his son's interview, and it's really wonderful in so many ways. And I should mention that this is the second time we've had Mr. Morgenstern here for Harlem Speaks, and we did a whole other one just basically on his life alone. So there's a million questions, of course, it would seem natural that I would ask, but tonight we're focusing on something else. I would share my own experience for 1 second, and I'm looking for the analog in yours, which was decades before mine. When I played in Eddie Durham's band, and I was a young white guy in an all-black band, and would go upstate and stay with his people, and I found that once I was vouched for by Eddie, that I was welcomed into this world in a way that I don't think the inverse would have been true. In other words, if a young African-American person in those days had come into where I came from, yeah, they would have been treated very nicely, I think, and respectfully, even though it was 40, 50 years ago. But I was welcomed into this world in a very special way because I was okay, and there was no BS. I don't know how to describe it. And I'm wondering, through your experience of being with Lips and with those kind of people, if you had those kind of familial, warm experiences in the Harlem community and going to the clubs, and they knew that you're with Lips, so you're okay.
Yeah. Well,
I'm curious about
that.
Well,
if you were pretty much, people who saw me with Lips and with Face and with everybody else, they figured that I was a musician, you know. So if you were a musician, you were accepted. I mean, that was fine, you know.
Right.
And especially if you were with Libs. Because that place, like the Lotus Club that we went to, very seldom were white people seen there. And, but it didn't matter. It was fine. You were there. You were there for a reason. You were there for the music. That was it.
I'd just like to thank Dan for the evening and say, how often are you in the presence of somebody who knew Alvin Berg and Lester Young?
They would have gotten along well.
Thank you so much for joining us for this Jazz for Curious Readers presentation of an interview, a conversation with the legendary Dan Morgenstern. The museum offers many programs, some historical, some interviews, many on contemporary issues that intersect in many and surprising ways with jazz. My name is Lauren Schoenberg. I'm the senior scholar at the museum. You can find out more about what we offer at our website, www.jmih.org, at our Facebook page, also on our YouTube channel, where many of these interviews ultimately live. On behalf of the staff, our board, our volunteers, everyone at the museum, we want to thank you so much for joining us, and we'll see you again.